There is something special about doing something in a game and knowing it affects other players. And I'm not talking about, like, killing a couple enemies and making the path clearer, or, you know, blowing somebody's ship up from the inside. Yeah, jerk. No, I'm talking about the general chaos of an MMO, being able to just do things in the game and know it affects the way the game plays. More specifically, though, I'm talking about player-made missions. And in today's Feature Watch, we're going to talk about player-made missions and the quantum economy, or Star Sim as they're starting to call it, and how these things are actually going to really affect the way this game flows. If you haven't been to a Feature Watch before, this is a small series where I just kind of take a topic from the last week of Star Citizen's development and give you a little bit of a deeper dive on the history and the plans for that in a more casual setting than the Tomato Talks. So, player-made missions are something that players have gotten a little bit nervous about over the last couple months, mainly because in 3.23, passenger transport beacons basically disappeared. Now, we don't know if that's a glitch or not, but this has made people a little more nervous about the beacon system taking a step back. But it's not. In fact, it's been acknowledged in the last Star Citizen Live that the system is, much like the economy, just not in a great place.
Player contracts and job boards. Will players ever be able to set up contracts to have cargo or items hauled by other players?
So, we do have player beacons. And I know what that current state of that is, but that is
it, Nick?
A system.
What is the current state? Go ahead, admit it.
Worked perfectly.
It's a feature, but that's something which we. It's like the economy. It's
non-existent. Sorry. Carry on, Nick.
Okay.
Yeah, this is pre-recorded, and if that still makes it into the show, know that I don't value my job.
Yeah, Elliot's still working at the company. Okay, it's good. Yeah. But ultimately, this answer we got from Nick after Elliot's little interruption was pretty good confirmation that player-made missions are very important to the game.
To answer the question, Elliot, the beacon system is something which provides for players to contract other players, and it's a system we will be looking to expand upon in the future. And personally, I think that this side of the economy is fundamental, given that we are having a hybrid economy, so player-driven systems.
Yeah, that's based tomato. Clip it.
We got you. While players won't exclusively control the economy in this game, allowing players to make missions for other people is going to be really good at keeping players engaged with each other and, like, keeping the game alive. And if you think about it, this is pretty key for solo players. If you didn't want to get involved in a huge group or sign up to get your friends online whenever you wanted to go do something, but you still wanted to take part in some of that bigger scaled gameplay, now you can do it without ever having to talk to people. You can just take missions that are assigned by other players, benefit from the fact that it's an MMO, but not necessarily have to go and get into a group. It's also really important, though, because it shows us the direction of the economy that's planned to be pretty dynamic and actually changing based on what players are doing, thus allowing you to affect other people's gameplay. This is actually pretty in line with what we've seen from previous quantum economy demonstrations, which we will get to in a little bit. Now, later in the same talk, it's actually specifically mentioned by Elliot that there will be chances for refineries or other locations to receive goods based on your cargo running route or your mining or whatever you're doing, and transform those goods into another good or a product, and then another mission would be generated somewhere in the verse that would require a cargo hauler to come pick up those goods and take them somewhere else, like a storefront or another factory. Now, we don't know which location would generate that mission, but this is a pretty important part of the economic chain that they had planned out for Quantum.
But yeah, we're gonna have missions where you have to bring resources to a location, and then naturally that location would then take those resources, produce something, and then another location would then consume what that location produces, and that makes the hauling sort of mission.
This was actually reflected in the March monthly report if you go back and look. It talked about how the economy team identified producers, transformers, and sinks for all resources, essentially categorizing all the locations, outposts, factories, cities, distribution centers within the economic chain. This is the Quantum system, soon to be officially known as Star Sim, it seems. They keep saying it.
Star Sim.
Constantly.
Star Sim.
Everywhere.
Star Sim.
And this is the overall economic simulation that's meant to actually make Star Citizen Interesting. Back in 2019, Tony Z, who, yes, is still working at the company, as confirmed by a couple of friends who ran into him back in May, did give us a good preview of the quantum system or what they had planned for it back then. Now, it is a frustrating watch because it's taken so long to get here, but let's look back at those demonstrations.
We're going to add a little bit of interest to the system by adding an aluminum mine to Delamar. So now we're going to go ahead and add an aluminum refinery to Crusader. That refinery, it wants to build up a stockpile of aluminum. And in order to do that, it needs some raw aluminum ore. And thus, it's willing to pay for it. And so the Quanta are seizing upon that economic opportunity, heading out to Delamar, doing the work, extracting that ore, and taking it back to the refinery. And this will continue until it's full. So what we're going to do now is add a factory. But before we do that, let's head on over to the power plant formula. And you can see here that building a power plant, just like refining ore, requires something. It requires 10 workers working for a duration of 60 ticks. And it also, notably, requires 2 units of refined aluminum ore in order to produce 1 power plant.
It's got to be more complicated than that, I promise.
They'll actually require ships. Ships require engines. And so all of a sudden, there's a real demand for how many power plants do you need? How many ships do you need? It all follows those same, you know, logical equations.
While this process could include players or AI, this is still pretty consistent messaging on what they want the economy to do and how they want it to change based on what players and AI are doing on the micro scale. The economy itself was originally meant to be a 10-to-1 ratio of AI to players in the game, so that players could have an effect on what's going on, but maybe not completely screw up planetary economies. Like, nobody wants there to be an overabundant supply of human waste on Hurston, but you know there's going to be an org that's trying to make that happen. This whole idea is supposed to allow for price changes, resource droughts, or even an overabundance of goods. Like human waste. The kind of events that might push you to stockpile your commodities until you'll get better profit for selling them, or run a specific trade route on a specific date because there may be a blockade. Not talking about blockade runner, get out of here. Go. Shoot. But this still allows for there to be guardrails for the economy to self-correct through the simulation rather than having to depend on players to go and fix it eventually. This also means if there are no players to take responsibility in some certain geographic part of the game, eventually the game will still do that for you, like a medical beacon, a transportation beacon, or an escort. Chris Roberts says this much back in 2015, I believe, on a Reverse the Verse episode.
In general, even if we have millions of players playing the game, as you move around, you are probably more likely to encounter more AI than you are players, because we need it to have a world feel alive, which is one of the big differences with what the Star Citizen setup is, building this alive world. And to do it properly, we can't rely on the player base, because at a certain time of night there may not be that many players, and then another time there could be a lot of them. So that's why we have this rule that the player base is going to be no more than 10% of the overall sort of population of the universe. And so at that point, most of the people, by the very definition, if that's the case, 9 out of 10 of the people, ships that you will meet will be AI. They will not be players.
We don't know how closely this is all still intended to be a part of the game, as it hasn't been explicitly stated that we're going to be a 10% part of the game since then, but that's kind of what we've been acting on, and the simulations that they've shown with Quantum definitely give the idea that AI are going to be a huge part of the traffic, the missions, the people you encounter, and the things that you do, so that you don't really have to worry about the unpredictability of players. Yeah, we like to break things. And this brings us back to those player-made missions. They could go much further than just commodity orders to a new location. We're talking data orders to survey a planet or find points of interest for you and your org to go and then exploit. Delivery missions to have vehicles transported to a certain location. Or simple requests for good engineers, turret gunners, or deckhands that could help you build out your crew when you don't have any friends. But in order for this to work, they're going to have to rely pretty heavily on that reputation system that has been oh so slow to build out in order to make players even feel comfortable doing all of this. And also, I really hope that they do have actual job boards or public places on space stations where you can go and find your local missions. That'd be a nice touch, but I bet a lot of people would want to just use their Moby Glass. We'll see what they do. But the point I wanted to hit here was that the economy is still in the works, in a big way, StarSim, Quantum, whatever you want to call it, just not Quanta, is still heavily in the works. And as we covered earlier this year with the video about Tony Z and the whole simulation, I would go check that out, there's more detail there. It's something they want to rely on for a lot of the dynamic gameplay in the game. And they've covered this in monthly reports and various talks throughout this year, so that's not going anywhere. We just don't know the details of it, and I don't know when we will. Honestly, that doesn't feel like something that's going to be very significant until after server meshing is in a good place, but this year they've talked about it way more than any other year. So I do think with the economy team working, the way they've been balancing prices across the monthly reports, talking about boosting mission payouts and figuring out how much risk versus reward gets you what you're paid, things are starting to get at least dialed in to be tuned into this system. I can't tell you it's going to be here soon, but it's definitely still coming. And this is ultimately good because it gives players the ability to affect the game's space, and give other people something to do based on your own gameplay. And honestly, a lot of you have bought tons of ships that you probably don't know exactly what to do with when you're just out there playing casually. Maybe this will give us the ability to loan out ships to people to run missions for us, start your own cargo company, and just loan out all your cargo haulers to people who get a little bit of the cut when they deliver stuff, and you just go off and do your own thing. I don't know, there's a lot of possibilities with this, with player-made missions, and the fact that the economy is going to be dynamic, and I'm loving it. But that's it for this feature watch. I do want to say I released a video recently about the Turbulent Studio, and I would like to make note that there are things in that video that are a little bit incorrect in terms of who's doing what in the company. It's a little hard to get it all exactly right based on just inside Star Citizens and Star Citizen Live, but I appreciate the CIG folks who have reached out to kind of correct some of that stuff, and I hope to make more videos that talk a little bit about the teams and what they've been doing. So if you are at CIG and you want to clarify anything or let us know anything more, obviously don't get in trouble. My DMs are open. I hope you guys have been enjoying this series. Please let me know more of what you would like to see from it. I'm just picking topics from the previous week, but there are all these little things that might get past me. So if you see something that's cool, hop on our Discord server. Come chat it out, let me know, or join us live for our deep dives where we go into way more detail on these kinds of things than we do here. In fact, we did cover this episode just recently, and I'll have that up on the second channel for you. Anyways, hope you enjoyed this one and learned something new, and I'll catch you in the next.